Welcome, everyone. Thank you for coming for this event. We're especially privileged to have Mr. George Weigel here with us. Many of you know he's a senior fellow at the Ethics and Public Policy Center, Washington, D.C., internationally known, a Vatican commentator for NBC, and a prolific writer. Some of his books are out in the gathering area if you'd like to purchase any. So without any further ado, let's welcome Mr. Weigel.
Well, it's wonderful to be here in Marquette. My second trip to the UP, my first trip to Marquette, I am just overwhelmed by the beauty of this cathedral. Congratulations to all of you for making the other St. Peter's such a magnificent place of worship. This was advertised for young adults. We're obviously stretching the definition of young adults a little bit here today, but that's fine. I'll consider myself a young adult for purposes of this. But I do want to address at least my formal remarks primarily to the young people here. And I want to talk about St. John Paul II, because last April 27th, just a few months ago, I had the rather extraordinary experience of being present for and doing television commentary about the canonization of someone I had known for 15 years, a man with whom I had had dozens and dozens of hours of conversation, man with whom I had laughed and cried, a man whose life I spent the better part of 15 years of my life cropped in two books, Witness to Hope and The End and the Beginning. And that experience of seeing someone I knew very, very well, had written some 1,500 pages of biography, prompted me to think about his road to that day. What does it mean when the church canonizes someone? There's a lot of confusion over this, I think, which I hope we avoided on NBC. There's this sense that the Pope makes a saint, or the Church is making, in the case of April 27th, two new saints, John the 23rd and John Paul II. Well, the truth of the matter is that the Pope doesn't make saints, and the Church doesn't make saints. God makes saints. The Church, acting through the Pope, recognizes saints that God has made, that the grace of God has made. And what's the definition that the church uses in identifying sanctity? Well, for hundreds of years, the criterion has been heroic virtue, an exceptional living out of the three theological virtues, faith, hope, and love, and the four cardinal virtues, prudence, justice, courage, moderation. As it happens, because I had written this very large first volume of the biography of John Paul II, I was asked by the Holy See to be one of the official witnesses for the beatification and canonization cause of John Paul II. And I found it a very interesting exercise because the questionnaire that I was to complete, testimony I was to give, was organized around this business of virtues. I was asked to think about his life through the prism of the heroic exercise of faith, hope, and love, and the heroic exercise of prudence, justice, courage, and moderation. And in fact, I was so taken with that way of thinking about his life, having spent a decade or more thinking about and writing about his life in a chronological way, this happened and this happened and this happened, that I adopted that structure, that outline of the virtues, as a way to try to sum up the character of this man in the last section of the second volume of my biography of John Paul II, The End and the Beginning. If we put all of that together, the theological virtues and the cardinal virtues, what we get is a kind of template of a Christian character, a soul, if you will, a person who is so transparent to the grace of God at work in his life that he becomes an instrument of encounter with God for others. He's so transparent to what God is doing in his life that other people can come to meet the Lord Jesus, can experience the work of the Holy Spirit, know the mercy of God the Father by meeting him. That's something extraordinary. Although John Paul II, who celebrated more beatifications and canonizations than all of his papal predecessors put together, would say it's not so extraordinary as it is. There are saints all around us. We have to learn to be more attentive the saints that God is making all around us. Now, that kind of transparency to God's grace in your life is something that develops over a lifetime. In some cases, it starts late. We all remember the story of the conversion of St. Augustine, in his 30s, I guess, when he accepted the Lord Jesus and became a Christian. And that work of becoming transparent began in him when he was in, fifth century, was middle age. Maybe we would call him a young adult. Boy, this is a tough crowd. Nobody wears anything. I know you had a hard winter last year. Try to get it. St. Peter, for whom this great cathedral is named, is another person who was converted late in life. And those tend to be the more dramatic stories of how God makes saints, people who come to sanctity later. There's a very interesting beatification cause going on right now in France. For example, the man's name was Jacques Fesch. He was convicted of homicide, was sentenced to be executed on the guillotine, had a tremendous conversion experience in prison, wrote extraordinary letters from prison to his family and others that are very rich spiritually. He was executed for his crime, but those letters are now the basis of the beatification. It's very dramatic business. With Carol Wojtyla and John Paul II, while it is certainly true that that capacity to be transparent, to be a reflection of God's grace in his own life so that others can come to experience that, developed over a lifetime. In fact, it developed right up to the end of his life. The last 5 months of his life were extraordinary witness to the dignity of suffering when that suffering is identified with the cross of Christ. But in the case of Karol Wojtyła, John Paul II, that road to canonization really began when he was the age of some of the really young adults in this crowd here this afternoon. It began in his hometown, a little town of some 10,000 people in those days called Wadowice. It's about 40 kilometers southwest of Kraków, where he lived with his family until he went to Kraków for the university in 1938. His mother died before his 9th birthday. His older brother, the doctor, died when young Karol was 12 years old. He was a physician who contracted scarlet fever from a patient he was treating and died from that. So for the last 6 years of his young life in his hometown, the future pope was raised by his father, a retired military man, whom I think was one of the two most significant figures in forming the character of the man who became the priest, the bishop, and the pope. His father was a man of granite-like integrity, and he was a man of constant prayer. In his vocational memoir, Gift and Mystery, which John Paul II wrote for the 50th anniversary of his priestly ordination in 1996, he talks about living with his father being, quote, in a sense, my first seminary. And the experience of seeing this dignified old school gentleman go down on his knees in prayer every night taught young Karol Wojtyła a very important lesson, that being adult, being an adult, and being a person of prayer are the same thing. There's nothing childlike about going down on your knees in prayer before the mystery of God and his love for us. I think that experience with his father began shortly, that experience of his father as a kind of first spiritual director, if you will, began shortly after his mother's death. Between Wadowice and Kraków is a remarkable place in Poland called Kalwaria Zebrzydowska. Zebrzydowski's Calvary. It's an outdoor Holy Land shrine that extends over dozens of acres, and there are 42 chapels, the 14 traditional stations of the cross, and 28 other chapels that allow you to kind of live the experience of your passion by walking through these trails and the woods and hills in the foothills of the Tatra. Shortly after Emilia Wojtyła, the late Pope's mother, died, his father took the 9-year-old Karol to the annual Passion Play at Kalwaria Zebrzydowska, which happens during Holy Week. And unlike the famous German Passion Play at Oberammergau in Germany, it's not a one-day deal. And it's not on a stage. It's a 3-day event, and everyone walks through the events of the Passion with the Lord, and with the disciples, and with the Romans, and with the people of Jerusalem, and with Our Lady and the Holy Women of Jerusalem. So at 9 years old, this young boy is learning to live inside the biblical story. He's learning that salvation history, the story of God's work in this world for our redemption, is not something on the side while world history is going on. He's learning that salvation history, the story of God's work with us, is going on inside world history all the time. And he begins to think about that, living inside the biblical narrative, to use that horrible word of the moment, to live inside the biblical story from a very young age. Then, after he goes to Krakow and has 1 year of study at the Evangelical University, then comes the Second World War. It's very difficult for Americans, even the families of World War II veterans, to understand just what that experience was like in Poland. Between September 1st, 1939, when Poland was invaded by Nazi Germany, and January 1945, when Poland was liberated, to use the word loosely, by the Soviet Army, and then, of course, subjugated again by communism. In those years, one in every five people in Poland died. 20% mortality rate. From September 1st, 1939 to January 1945. Part of the country was eaten, absorbed by the Soviet Union. Another part, a smaller part, was eaten by Nazi Germany, and the part left in the middle was run by a gangster named Hans Frank, out of the royal castle of Wawel in Krakow. And the historian Norman Davies calls that middle part, the former formal title was the general government, Gestapo. It was a big chunk of Poland where there was no rule of law, where the Poles were to be kept alive on a minimum diet so that they could work for the greater glory of the Third Reich, and eventually dying. Poland will be eliminated, was Hans Frank's description of what the long-term plan was. And in that environment, where if Gestapo agent or an SS officer or even a German military man didn't like the way you looked at him on the street, he could shoot you down and nothing would happen to you. Some of you may have seen the film Schindler's List, which was of course filmed in Krakow, so you get some sense of the depth of the evil that was abroad at those days. One of John Paul II's friends from that period said to me 20 some years ago, in those years, it was not a question of knowing whether you would be alive on your next birthday or alive at Christmas. For 5.5 years, it was a question of not knowing whether you would be alive tomorrow night. In that same book, Gift and Mystery, that I mentioned a moment ago, John Paul II tells about a classmate of his in the underground seminary whom he was supposed to serve Mass with at the Archbishop's house one morning, 1944. The other guy didn't show up after Mass. A terrible deal, went out to look for him, and he found his name on a poster of people who were to be executed. That's how he lived from age 19 to age 24, not knowing whether you would be alive tomorrow night. Yeah. In those extraordinary circumstances, different things happen to different people. Some people literally lost their minds, went crazy, and died. Some people disappeared into the forests, tried to find guns, conduct guerrilla warfare against the enemy. Some people decided they would try to build a worldly utopia in the future. They joined the Communist Party. Most people, as in most extreme circumstances, in most moments in history, most people sort of muddled through, tried to get through it all somehow. It was a time in Poland that I've often compared to what goes on beneath the surface of the earth. We know that beneath the crust of the earth, there are all of these tremendous forces and pressures. And sometimes they can be very destructive. They burst out of that crust of the earth in volcanic explosions. The seabed erupts and you get tsunamis. Lava does tremendous damage. There's all kinds of fiery, nasty, powerful stuff going on underneath the crust of the earth that can do a lot of damage. That's something like the pressure of living at that moment. But we also know that in addition to volcanic eruptions, lava flows, and tsunamis, and all that stuff, those pressures under the earth form something else. They form diamonds. Diamonds are the hardest, clearest substance on this planet. They can cut through things that nothing else can cut through, like the Berlin Wall. They can reflect light in an extraordinarily beautiful way. That's what happened, Carol Wojtyła, during the pressures of the Second World War. He became a kind of diamond, capable of cutting through things that seem uncut through. And he became someone who reflected light, in this case, light of God, in an extraordinary way. In the early 1980s, mid-1980s, a woman named Elena Bonner, who was the wife of Andrei Sokolov, who was a great Russian nuclear physicist and had become a great campaigner for human rights in the last years of the old Soviet Union. Elena Bonner came to Rome, and she met privately for 2 hours with John Paul II. She was of Jewish descent. She had no particular religious conviction. She was a very, very tough lady who had survived 20 years of bludgeoning by this totalitarian communist system. And she came out of that meeting with John Paul II in tears and said to a friend of hers, a Russian Italian lady who became a friend of mine, told me this story, "He's the most extraordinary person I've ever met. He is all light. He is a source of light." That's the diamond that was formed when he was the age of some of you here in Krakow. That diamond was refined over more than 30 years as one of the most dynamic priests and bishops of his time, and a lot of the, if you will, cutting of the diamond and buffing of the diamond and making it even more beautiful was done by lay people and was done specifically by young people. If you asked the popes of the 19th and 20th centuries before John Paul II. Tell me about your first years of priesthood. The pope in question, most of them, would talk about going to the graduate school in Rome where the Vatican trains its diplomats. They talk about going to a Vatican embassy abroad and working there. They talk about teaching in a seminary. If you ask John Paul II, as I had the occasion to do more than once, tell me about your early years in the priesthood. He talks about him. He talked about being a university chaplain. He talked about how important it was for him to have regular, ongoing contact, both in terms of pastoral contact and in terms of human friendship, with the young people whom he served as a university chaplain for many years in Christ. Those young people, men and women, became his close friends. And they remained his close friends for his entire life. It was an extraordinary story of this completely priestly priest. Being formed into that priesthood by laymen, with no confusion, but with a real mutual exchange of gifts, as we sometimes say. And in a beautiful moment, on April 8th, 2005, 70 of those young people, now not so young anymore, with whom Carol Wojtyła had hiked, camped, kayaked, skied, all that outdoor stuff, were seated at his funeral right behind all of the heads of state and government from all over the world. And they were seated there in hiking clothes because 70 of them had decided at the last minute to come to the funeral. They had no idea whether they could get in. They were planning on sleeping overnight in a park in Rome. And they called the Pope's secretary, who had known them all for 30 years, and he got the tickets right behind the President of the United States, and the President of France, and the King of this, that, and the other thing. There they were, you know, in L.L. Bean, old L.L. Bean stuff. So that marked, you know, the end of an extraordinary arc of friendship and spiritual development that, among other things, gave the church World Youth Day. Has anybody here been to a World Youth Day? Very good. Who's going to Cracker from 2016 for the World Youth Day? Good. There's going to be a great guidebook written by my son and me coming out for that. keep your eyes open. World Youth Day began, formally began in 1984. But it really began back in Krakow in those friendships between Wojtyła and his kids, as he called them. This past July 4th, I was in Krakow. I teach there every July. And two of those kids, who are not kids anymore, we're celebrating their 50th wedding anniversary in Wawel Cathedral, in the Blessed Sacrament Chapel, where they had been married on July 4th, 1964, by the Archbishop of Krakow, St. John Paul II. And they invited my son, who was in Krakow with me, to do the photography for this book we're working on, and me to the Mass, and then to a dinner. And I looked at that couple and their friends, many of whom have become my friends over the past 20 years, outside the cathedral, doing what Poles do, flowers everywhere, people giving people lots of flowers. And I said to my son, you are looking at the beginning of world history. These people are the beginning of world history. They're not young, they're in their 70s, and some of them are in their 80s. But this is where all of that started, this extraordinary thing that has become part of the rhythm of the life of the Catholic Church throughout the world. It began back there while these young people were helping polish the diamond that became John Paul II. I have been asked probably hundreds of times, how do I account for the extraordinary magnetism that John Paul II had for young people? The usual media answer, except on NBC, of course, is it's celebrity stuff. It's, you know, kids like celebrities. Well, that doesn't work, because he didn't look like any celebrity I know of, particularly in the last 6 or 7 years. And he never treated young people the way most celebrities do. My answer is that John Paul II was immensely attractive to young people for two reasons. The first reason was that he was transparently honest with young people. He didn't ask young people, older people for that matter, to do anything that he hadn't had to do himself, to bear any burden that he had not borne, to take any risk that he had not already taken. I mean, he could ask because he had been there himself. And the second reason I think he was immensely compelling is that he did not pander to young people. All of you, all of us in this consumer society of ours are pandered to all the time. But young people are especially pandered. You're told you're great, all that you can be, you can do whatever you like, if it itches, scratch it, and the rest of us will accommodate to you. And, you know, go through any mall in America, that's the message you get, right? Watch TV, that's the message you get. And here comes this middle-aged or elderly Polish bishop, the elder bishop of, and he does not pay. He says in any number of variations on one great theme, don't ever settle for anything less than the spiritual and moral greatness that God's grace can make possible. Don't ever settle for anything. You won't succeed all the time. You'll fail. We all fail. But failure is no reason to lower the bar of expectation. Get up, dust yourself off, seek forgiveness and reconciliation, try again. But don't ever settle for anything less than, to go back to the beginning, heroic sanctity, heroic virtue, because that's what you're capable of if you cooperate with the grace of God. Another way to think about saints, maybe draw this part of the afternoon to conclusion, and then we can have a conversation with it, is to think about saints this way, following the British author C.S. Lewis, who once wrote, "Saints are people who can live comfortably with God." Lewis wrote, "If most of us were snatched up to the throne of grace today, we would feel a little uncomfortable. Wouldn't be quite sure what's going on, how to behave, how to handle this. Saints are people who through a lifetime, whether that's a lifetime as short as a little flower, 24 years, their life as long and dramatic as John Paul II, almost 85 years. Saints are people who can live comfortably with God forever, because they have become light for others, or diamonds who can reflect God's light to others. They can live, saints can live, in the light of love, the blinding light of love of the Holy Trinity, forever, comfortable, happy, in what the Lord called in the Sermon on the Mount, Beatitude. And that's, I think, the final lesson from the life of John Paul II, not only for young people, but for all of us. Sainthood is our baptismal vocation. We've all got to become saints if we are going to fulfill our Christian and human destiny, which is to live forever in the light and love of the Holy Trinity. Some of us, that's going to take longer than a lifetime. Church calls that purgatory. Some people are so spectacularly holy in this life that they can live comfortably immediately in the divine presence. But that's what we all have to be. Because to be able to enjoy the wedding feast of the Lamb, 21st chapter of the book of Revelation, that's the end of the story. The end of the story of history, the end of the story of creation is an enormous heart attack. It goes on forever. In order not to feel like you're crashing the party, you have to become that kind of God. And to have seen that unfold in our own time, under these late 20th, early 21st century circumstances, has been an extraordinary thing, extraordinary gift to the whole church. And you could feel that at John Paul II's hymn. 3 million people descended on Rome within 2 days for the funeral of John Paul II. The city of Rome doubled in population in about 72 years. And the sentiment you could feel in the streets was gratitude. The primary emotion of the moment was not sadness, although there was certainly that. It was gratitude. Gratitude for a life that had been so transparent to grace that it could be an instrument of encounter with God for others. So, there are a few thoughts on the life of St. John Paul II, the importance of young people in that life, and I would be happy to answer any questions that any of you might have. Thank you.